So we are doubly blessed because Pastor Jack Phillips is going to come and speak with us this afternoon. No spoiler alerts, but it is about mission and how to go out and to handle when we're out witnessing for the Lord. So that is a vital part of what we're hoping that the Holy Spirit will do for us. And I don't know about you, but I need all of the help that I can get. So turning it over to you, Pastor.
Thank you so much, the words. If you've been blessed so far, let me hear the church say amen. Take time to be holy is the words of the song. And I'm so happy that hello, the lights were changed, right? The bulbs were changed?
Amen.
Okay. Feels different. From the it is brighter. Yeah, it's brighter. So bright is good. All right. I think that the last one were warm. They were more the warm bulbs, right? But these apart from the ones from nonetheless, we're very pleased to be here to participate. I want to say a big thank you to Sister Deborah and her team that have helped us to keep grounded, seeking constant guidance from the Holy Spirit, from the Godhead, to be focused, to be grounded on a platform that will help us to grow spiritually. And so it is only as quality time is designated and put aside for us to come together. This prayer and fasting is not something that is fashionable. And so it's not for the weak. It's going to be for the strong. And we need to make time for this because this is what will by and large determine how strong our church is in the long run. If we take the time to do this, then there's no telling what God will do through us, because spiritual things are spiritually discerned. Long ago, after several months of having invited our presenter, Jack, to be with us, part of the conversations that we had was how, as a church, we are a spiritual body, but how do we deal with rejection? It is very easy that when you and I go out to connect with people, to reach people, to share the love of Christ, to testify, that sometimes when the responses come to us, it is not so inviting. It bruises us. And some person will say, oh no, this was not made for me. I'm not doing this anymore. Let pastor do it. Or let those who are more seasoned do it. But there's a statement that Ellen White, I was just trying to find on my phone before I come up here, that she said there is no substitute. So there are persons who will say, oh, let that one do it. But she said there is no substitute. From once, I mentioned that statement last week, that from once you and I have been baptized into the body of Christ, the receiver becomes the giver. Because when you think of where you've been to where God has placed you, that you and I can't help to not want to share him, because we are now in light and no longer in darkness. But I want to point to you, last week I pointed to this side, this time I pointed to my right. And the statement from Ellen White says that God calls upon every church member, very specific, to enter his what? His service. Truth that is not what? Lived. That is not imparted to others. Loses its life-giving what? Power. It's healing virtue. So if you and I don't use, I don't see my children. But we have a responsibility that what God has given to us. Okay, just making sure. Thank you so much. So we want to ensure that while we are receiving, because we don't want to be like the Dead Sea, that we are receiving all of these information, but how much of it is being shared? And so we have become so good at listening that we are becoming obese. We are becoming spiritually obese because we're not sharing, we're not utilizing the opportunities that we receive to our neighbors, to our family members, to our friends. And so the question then begs, how do I continue to provide spiritual witnessing even in the midst of rejection, even when there's pushback, even when there are persons who oppose what we teach. And so it is in that vein that we have Jack remaining with us to do this, and even so to participate in this, our very spiritual affair, as it is for prayer and fasting. And so without further ado, he has been appropriately addressed, introduced rather to us this morning. And so we invite him back to guide us into this next study. And then thereafter, Sister Jewel will return for that special song.
So each of you should have this. It says, reach your neighbor. That's really, it's Reach Your Neighbor Leads program. That's the program of the conference that I happen to be coordinating. And that is to help all of us get involved sharing Jesus. And I believe most of us here are actively, if not all of us, are actively sharing Christ in our lives. You have this sheet. It's called A Vision of Berries. Has anybody read this before? All right, one, two. All right, I'm going to. It's bright. All right. But I know I need the mic, so we'll do this. What we're going to do is take a few minutes to read this. It's taken from a book called Gospel Workers. Anybody read Gospel Workers?
Yes, sir.
All right. Anybody read something from Gospel Workers? All right. I love this book. I really enjoy it. I thought it was very handy for me as getting into sharing Christ. When I first became a Seventh-day Adventist, I couldn't wait to share what I had been learning. When I started walking with the Lord, I wanted nothing more than to share that with somebody else. But as I sought advice and guidance on how to do it, the particular church that I came into did not have anybody that knew really anything about sharing their faith. The church had kind of fallen away from getting involved in that, and I just happened to walk in off the street, and so had anybody else who had recently been baptized in that church. They hadn't really been reaching out. So as I went out to reach out, I made every mistake you can think of. If you've been out making a mistake, I probably made that mistake as well. And I am thankful for the Lord's patience with us in those mistakes. He doesn't hold it over us, but is glad we're out there doing it. And as was done for me, he can work even in those mistakes. So we're going to do a little bit over sharing, and our main focus today will be over dealing with rejection. But I brought this for you today. Two had read this. You're going to love it. You're going to love it. Now, it takes 10 minutes to read it. 10 minutes is what it takes to read it. It's front and back. It's front and back. And what we're going to do is, as you read it, you need a pen. Because you need to write on this thing. Everywhere you see something about evangelism, you got to scratch on there, you got to underline it, you got to make some notes. This is why it's about evangelism. You need to circle it and draw some lines, connecting some dots. When we get done, this thing should be covered in scratches and marks and writing, okay? Now, what are we marking about?
Evangelism.
Sharing Jesus Christ. So anywhere you see lessons about sharing Jesus Christ, mark, highlight, write them down, write down what it means to you, and then we're going to take some time and discuss that afterwards. If you are viewing online, you can find this quickly on the internet. All you need to search is Gathering the Fruit, A Dream, or you can search for the book Gospel Workers, pages 136 to 139. And it's available for you if you were watching at home, or you may have that book on a shelf somewhere. Gospel Workers, pages 136 to 139. Go ahead and start reading, and in about 10 minutes from now, we'll start discussing it. There's pencils going around if you don't have one. I think I lost the pen that Pastor gave me. I told him I wouldn't get it back to him. Let's see if I can find another. I'm going to mute myself.
under a minute left.
That he would die.
May not have finished, that's okay. I know some of you are approaching that ending mark and you want to get through with it. We're going to take a moment. There's going to be there's a mic here, there's a mic there. And what we're going to do is take a moment and share what you saw about evangelism. And something I need to make sure is as we discuss, we don't want to take time putting down anybody else. This is really not a time to critique or say, well, if so-and-so would have done, or if the conference would have done. This is a time for us personally, as individuals, to examine what we could do, what lessons we're learning, what encouragement we have here. And so as we go through it, we can start anywhere you like, but just please tell us where you're speaking from. Give us a point, and we'll take turns. We'll hop around. You can have another turn if you like, but tell us where you're reading from. If it's the third paragraph on the first page, so we can come there and look at it with you, and then if you can share with us why it means something, what it means to you concerning evangelism, sharing Jesus. So, whoever wants to go first. Mike's right back here. Mike's. Mike, not beyond.
I'm looking at the third paragraph.
There it goes.
Where she said, some of the nice large berries have fallen to the ground and were consumed by worms and insects. So I underlined that to suggest that they were not attended to.
Mm.
These were huge berries, which means they were obviously seen, but because nobody paid attention to them or picked them, worms and insects ate them. And I would align that to the evils of this world, situations that come upon these persons. And then for the other one, 1, 2, 3, fourth paragraph, just in the first line, he said, just then two or three of the party came sauntering around where was. They were chatting and seemed to be occupied with each other's company. So we have persons who can see what's going on because they said they looked and they didn't see any fruit, but they were like persons who were doubting, you know, I just don't see any because they were occupied talking.
Thank you. So occupied talking instead of noticing the fruit that was obviously there. Distracted.
Okay, I look at the second paragraph. It says, soon the wagon halted and the party scattered in every direction to look for the fruit. All around the wagon were both high and low bushes bearing large, beautiful whole berries. I circled the green berries on the right. Because it's interesting, everybody took off, but like in the same location, you know, there were bright berries there. If they took the time, they would have found, you know, the ripe ones there. And I think the bushes being high kind of distracted. Well, it was high and low bushes. It distracted them because they didn't take time to dig deep. But I wanted to know the green berries. There was a separation because she didn't want to pick the green one. Is it because they weren't ready yet? I want to know how to differentiate.
That's right. They weren't ready yet. Any of y'all ever pick a mango?
Yes.
You eat the green mango. Okay. I don't even know what to say then. We got to move on past. All right. Now, but when you go to pick a mango, if it's ripe, when you grab a hold of it, what happens? If it is green, you got to rip that thing. bite it off of that tree, right? So here's the thing. Mangoes, berries, if it is green, it is not good for anybody. I mean, I know you like a green mango. Just come with me on this, though. All right? It's bitter. It damages the plant. It's not fun for the berry. And it isn't fun for the church. It's not fun for the person who picked it. It's a bad experience. This person wasn't ready to be picked yet. But so she was careful not to harm them. She was real careful with these green berries. Very good. We got others over here. We got another one here. She here and then over here.
Okay. The first thing that I noticed was in the first paragraph, the last sentence, a large wagon laden with provisions for our company went before us. So they already had everything that they needed to be able to harvest the berries.
Mm-hmm.
And then I notice in the 1, 2, 3, 4th, I'll go to the 6th paragraph, where Ellen White is telling the other people who are picking that they didn't find any berries because they didn't look close enough. So it's, if we are not finding people to witness to, it's because we're not looking for them. And it goes on to say it does not hang on the outside of the bushes. You must search for it. So they may not be obvious and right in front of our face, but through the provisions on the wagon, which probably includes prayer and the Holy Spirit, then the Lord will show us through a little bit of looking where to find those to witness to.
Amen. Thank you for sharing that. So if we look close enough, now, I gotta say something. You already said it, but I'm going to ask again. There were green berries and there were ripe berries. How did they know what was green versus what was ripe? How do we know what is green versus ripe? How do we find out if a person is green or ripe? We're going to have to talk with them. What else? We have to build a relationship with even the green berries.
Yeah.
Yes. Because then she said, when you come back, they'll be ready.
When you come back, they might be ready. I got one over here. I'm sorry. I'm going to come back.
So I'm the first paragraph on the second page. Then said I, will you take care of these berries and then go with me to look for more? But they had made no preparation to care for the fruit. There were dishes and sacks in abundance, but they had been used to hold food. So here we find that even after we have gone out and we've brought people in the berries, then we have made provision to keep them, to nurture them. And so they're going to go out. You know, if we're not taking care of them, then we're going to lose them. So that tells us that when we bring people in, then we have to make provision to keep them in the church. And then the second to last paragraph, the lesson that you gave this day to those who are learning, who are just learning how to do this kind of work, will be copied by them. Uh-huh. So when we, you know, as a church, we're supposed to be guiding our children to be just as, you know, to do this work, right? So that when we can no longer do it, they can't. But if we're not setting the right example for them, our young people, then what's going to happen? So
very good. So some good lessons there. What happens to the berries, or use the berry illustration, but what happens if we bring berries into the wagon, but we haven't had anything to preserve them? They're going to spoil there rather than on the ground. But they're going to spoil right in the church if we don't take care of them. That berry will spoil right there. Go ahead. And then
the book.
There's people online.
Okay. How do we know when the berries are ripe?
Mm-hmm.
And the question that I thought about in terms of the answer is, especially the mangoes, you go and you shake the tree.
Mm.
So when you shake the tree, if they're really ripe, they're going to fall.
They fall right.
So it is, you know, when you go out to witness, if somebody's really ready, they come
right. Yeah. And I'm going to bring this home over and over, and thank you for bringing that out. We're going to bring that home over and over in in our little bit of time together. Right here, them right there, yes. And then right here. Okay.
The paragraph that gets to me is like the fourth paragraph toward the second half of the fourth paragraph when he said, there's no more to be gathered from these bushes. They began picking but soon stopped, saying, it is not fair for us to pick up here. We found this path and the food is yours. But I reply, that make no difference. Gather wherever, this is the part I want to point, gather wherever you can find anything. This is God's field. You cannot pick and choose, no discrimination while you go to the field. This is God's children. Jesus died for everybody. They want to be saved. He needs to save them too. And these are his berries. It is not our berries. It is berries. He chose you to save them. So you go forth and do that. It is your privilege to pick them up. Just pick them up for him.
Amen.
Please, please.
Amen. I like it. So there are no territorial lines when it comes to God's kingdom and where we can pick and not pick. If God brings you across some ripe berries, well, you better pick. Because otherwise you're hoping someone else is going to come by and get them before they spoil. So pick while you're there. Right over here, Jeff.
The last paragraph on the first page has really got me thinking. It says, they all came to see fruit that she had gathered. They said, these are high bush berries, firm and good. We didn't think we could find anything on the high bushes, so we hunted for low bush berries only and found but few of these. That one's really getting my attention because there's bushes we avoid or overlook or say, I'm not even gonna try that. Like, I'm thinking of the story of the young man in the story in the apartment, like, that man, that would be someone I avoid, and that's you, and that's kind of convicting me right now.
Thank you for sharing. Right over here.
Okay, Sister Rachel just stated the one the first one that I had on here, about, gather wherever you can and find anything. This is God's field, and these are the berries. It is your privilege. So it is a privilege. You know, we know that it
she
is a privilege
a lot of places.
To reach out to these souls. The other one was in on the back, on paragraph 10, where it states, soon the night will be here in which we can gather no fruit. So that's just letting us know that, you know, time is, we're running out of time. We are running out of time to save souls because the night is here. You know, we're the end times. So we need to hurry. You know, this is one of the most important things that we need to focus on right now.
Thank you.
And also in paragraph 11 at the bottom.
Can you say which one it is on the back?
It's the very last paragraph.
Okay.
And it just talks about being diligent. And so it says, the berries nearest you, it talks about you should be diligent first to pick the berries nearest you and then to search for those farther away. After that, you can return and work nearby again, and thus you will be successful. So I look at that as, you know, I know that we're talking about the church here, but I like to reach out to my family, you know, because we also need to save souls in our families. So I reach out to my family first, and then my neighbors, you know, those on my street. And that's really kind of the first thing that I did was, you know, I passed out literature to my neighbors because they were nearest to me. So that's all.
So to be successful, she said, start near, find the right berries, then go find the right berries further away, and then come back to the close ripe berries again, find the ripe berries that have ripened since the last time you were there, and go away. Right over here. Very good. Oh, is it your turn?
Well, Sister Lynette, she had the sentence that I was going to read in the last paragraph, and she already read it. I have done missionary work. I've gone overseas several times during missionary work, and my missionary work is right in my own home. My husband, my children, my siblings, nieces and nephews. So this was very impactful to me about starting at the place nearest you.
Thank you for sharing that.
There are two classes of people are shown here. One that's kind of lazy and totally involved in themselves and their own needs and eating and being non-observant of their environment. So basically they bore no fruit. And then there's the other one, and it seems like he's went on his way because he's picking, I'm saying he, picking berries, but the truth is there's so many flaws here. Like in the last sentence of paragraph 2, I began to gather the fruit nearby, but very carefully, for fear of picking the green berries, which were so mingled with the ripe fruit that I could pick only one of two berries from a cluster. So he's kind of set up a situation where I'm gonna get the two best ones in here. And so how do you determine what that cluster actually represents? And how many fruit truly are ready for the harvest?
And they all, go ahead.
Yes. So there's a bit of arrogance there, and you know, I'm doing it right, and I'm gonna, you know. And then on the last sentence of paragraph 3, even if the whole berry is spoiled, because he went picking in the spoiled berries, even if the whole berry is spoiled, I can at least show the brethren what they might have found if they had not been too late. So there's real arrogance there, because he basically is, the reason he's doing it is wrong. He's going to show the brethren what they might have found if they had not been too late. So, you know, that's just, it's in many respects, it's kind of what we do. But I think it's unfortunate, and it stands in the way of real growth and ministry to actually garner in people for the kingdom.
Hmm. Thank you. Yeah, there's a, you notice a feeling that she's going through of feeling alone and feeling like the only person. And some frustration. You notice that here. There is a frustration where they just keep not, and she feels, and you get it, and she's like, I was alone again. You had your hand up?
I just wanted to say, you have to realize that her passion was different.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why it's not really arrogant. She had a different passion because, you know, she's seeing the others are like gathering and, you know, like having it be like something they're enjoying, but this was her.
One thing I noticed is that when I got into ministry and doing this, even when I first became a Christian, I thought everybody who wasn't, like, it was really hard for me to see people not doing it. And sometimes I would struggle with that. I'm going to go here and then here. I know you've been waiting for quite some time.
No, it's okay. I'll make it quick. So the part that my sister here touched on, I saw that part as well, and it brought me back to the story you told this morning when, you know, they looked at you and, you know, they didn't think, well, hey, you were worth staying a 5 minutes to give you Bible study, and it took you years before you had to come to God. So that part says, even the whole berry is spoiled, her picking it up to show them would be like, look at this, brethren, this is a soul that we could have saved had we not dilly-daddled, had we not stayed in the back, had we not run around, had we not been occupied with our own things instead of doing what the Lord, you know, wants us to do. And my last one, to kind of tie that in, what Sister Michelle on the back, when it says one responded, Sister White, I think is the second paragraph on the next page, it made me think that they were basically idle because she said, so she said, you know, why did you come if you were not prepared? You knew what we were going to do. You didn't bring no literature. You didn't bring no Bible, no nothing. You just tag along. And then they responded, oh, you wanted to go, so we just decided to tag along. So it showed me that they were not intentional. And like me, I'm guilty because I have books in my trunk. I gave out some, but I didn't continue. And when I found them the other day, I'm looking like, my friend said, I'm going to tell the pastor that you have books in your trunk. And I felt bad. They said in a funny way, but I'm like, you know, I wasn't intentional. I would put one every time I go to Ross or wherever. I'll put one in my bag, and I'd be like, can I share this with you? But I didn't continue. So this stood out to me because I saw me in this, you know? And then they're saying, no, it's like me and my sisters, we going out. Oh, Shan, you wanted to go, so we just decided to tag along. But we weren't trying to save souls. We weren't trying to pick berries. We just wanted to come. So as Christians, I think we should all be intentional, and that way the work, all the work that needs to be done, all the berries that need to be picked, we would have more people to do it, and the work of God would spread further, if that makes sense. That's how I...
Excellent. Makes perfect sense. Last one right here, and then I'll get your comment, and I believe she took yours, huh? She took it. All right.
In the second paragraph, I began to gather the fruit nearby, but very carefully. That little sentence right there. There are many times when in the evangelistic meetings, and being in, from a big city, we look for the number. We are looking at the numbers. So we baptized 120. And you come to a small congregation, we only baptize two. And sometimes we look at the number instead of the quality of what we are providing or giving out. And the other paragraph was for gather wherever you can find anything. And so sometimes we look, walk around the community looking for that nice house or a nice community. But it says, gather where you can find anything. And that means anywhere.
Thank you very much. A lot of great ideas. We cut it off after, you know, about 25 minutes or so. You could easily spend more time on this. Lots of great lessons. I had a comment back here real quick. She was had her hand up earlier.
Yeah, let me be very quick. I just wanted to add to what Natasha said. And I don't think it's... Sorry. And I don't think it's arrogance. I think she had great passion for what she did. And so in that lesson, she was trying to teach. You know, she was trying to teach while gathering. Say, let me pick this up and show them what they could have gathered if they had just stopped to do it.
Yes. And you had one? I can't cut the pastor off.
Okay, well, this exercise is very, very good, and I hope and trust that we are very good at doing lesson reviews and stuff like those, but I hope that something will stick with us after this afternoon, at least on this real encounter that Ellen White has in terms of a vision. I think that for me, the biggest takeaway, I would say, is that one, that there's a rebuke for us for missed opportunity. When you get to, because we all have 24 hours in one day, and opportunities after opportunities have been given to us to be a witness, and many of us feel that we still have more time. There is not that sense of urgency, there is not that sense of intentionality, and I believe that in more ways than not, that while we have to work our honest living to thrive and to prepare for the winter of our lives, that if we don't make hay now while the sun shines, because we are God's chosen people, we have been given a very peculiar message to be a witness, and we keep it to ourselves. Not only that, it's not only about being motivated on our own to be a witness, whether it is to share our own testimonies, to give our literature. But even when we have reaping programs, there is this kind of a, in light of the attitude has a lot to do with how we do what we do. Because you see the attitude of those who didn't really gather the grapes early enough until they were being counseled with. And if we don't have the right attitude, people are able to discern into us, because we're not the only ones who discern. People have, the Spirit of God is working with the average individual. And I would say that there's a rebuke for us for missed opportunities for individuals whose lives could have been saved. But I see also hope in the second to last paragraph on the back of the document, which says, the lesson that you have this day given to those who are just learning how to do this kind of work will be copied by them. So I believe that when we, whatever we do, we should do it the best possible way, because we are either positive influence or negative influence. And we want to positively impact those who are around us so that they can have best practices to do it right.
Amen. Thank you. So, sir, over here, just like you, mine got taken too. Mine got taken too. I always save a couple for me. Let's see what I can get. So, Pastor, you brought up the, it's copied by us. We are showing new Christians and our children what witnessing looks like. And their demonstration of what witnessing looked like and reaping and harvesting souls looked like was, let's play games. Let's bring food to eat. Let's hang out with our kids. Because, you know, once you have a kid, you can't share Jesus anymore. You know that, right? That ain't true. My daughter's been passing out tracts since she could walk. She's the one who's like, hey, Dad, let's go to the neighbors and take them food. Let's go to the neighbors and pass out these tracts. I'm like, I just want to eat dinner, kid. And she's like, come on, Dad, we got to go now. That's because that's what I taught her.
Yes.
Now I got to keep teaching her that. As I'm getting more tired in life, she is getting more zeal for the mission. So a kid can be part of what we do, or can be an excuse of why we don't do them. But kids are good no matter what, and playing games is good, and eating food is good. But that was the demonstration of witnessing they were giving to the younger group. And so it was going to be copied. When we do evangelism, we come together and we eat. And we come together and we play games. We come together and we do this, but our goal is the thing that happens afterward, not the thing. And when I came into the Seventh-day Adventist Church, no one was there to show me a positive example of sharing Jesus. But the example is to look close in your family, in your group, in your circle. I had nothing but non-Adventists in my life. And I had a lot of people to be looking through. You know when I'm studying with them? Now. Because no one taught me how then. So I witnessed like a jerk. Told them how they were all going to church on the wrong day. How they were eating incorrectly. And I won zero of them. And now I'm studying with them 15 years later. So I'm thankful for second chances. But the reality was is, there were people who were open then. Now there's people, as I've come back through, who are open now. And when I go back through again, there will be people open again. So share that demonstration. Do you know why they didn't find fruit? It says it in here a few different times. There was distractions. They weren't looking in the right places. But it says it in one way, one place. We didn't expect to find anything. She's like, it's right there. They're like, we didn't expect to find anything. We just came to hang out, you know. Get you off our back a little bit. I only say that because people have said that to me. When I first started, I was. But here's the reality. Their expectation defined their results. She expected to find fruit, and they didn't. She found it, and they did not. And our expectation of whether or not there is ripe fruit defines whether or not we'll see it. We'll have to look, but we have to know that there is ripe fruit there to find, and it's there, all around us. In fact, it is post-COVID, maybe, Who knows? But during COVID, I was in Minnesota, and in Minnesota, you couldn't do anything without a mask. You couldn't have people over your house. Thanksgiving, you had like two family members, and that's it. And everything was shut down everywhere. And when you went door to door, guess what happened? They were glad to see you. Man, I want to know what the Bible says about what's going on in this world right now. I never had such an easy time getting Bible studies as in during COVID. I'm going to tell you what, it was the best time to get Bible studies. And here, I'm going to let you in on a secret. It's still going on. We can get Bible studies as easy as anything. I've never got Bible studies as easy as right now because people are post-COVID, but it's still there. And the impacts of what is happening in the world are still in people's minds and hearts, and they're aware that something's happening. And if you're looking, there is ripe fruit right there. And if you have the guts, and I'm going to say this again, if you have the guts, because it's scary, to offer a Bible study, you will get Bible studies. You have to ask. I've only heard a couple stories where the person has tracked the person down, grabbed them by the shirt collar, and said, are you going to study the Bible with me or what? Because typically they're hoping or waiting on you to come to them. And they might be right there in your family. They might be right there next door. They might be at your work. They might be your cousin that you have seen 5 years ago. And every once in a while, they send you a message on Facebook. What time we end, Pastor? 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock, something like that. 8 o'clock. Because I know what's going to happen when we start sharing stories. We might have to come back. All right. But I like, he's the boss. That's why I asked him. But I like hearing stories. We heard some in here, but I'd like to hear, take a few minutes and hear some of your stories. And maybe we won't be able to hear them all, but we can take a few minutes and hear some of your stories of sharing Jesus. Something that has been successful recently is you've shared Jesus in 2 minutes or less for your turn. What I hear in Sabbath school this morning, 1 minute or less. I like that. Who was teaching Sabbath school and said that? I liked it. No one wants to admit it because it was good. I was like, we got to start using that. Go ahead, please.
So this one is, we shared Jesus. It was Andrea and I. We shared Jesus by just giving food, not literature per se. So where we work, we always see, when we're leaving work, we always see an individual by the side. And the light is never really red for us to give him something because she always has a juice. I have a sandwich or something. And then, you know, we prayed, he's like, Lord, help us to be able to give him something, right? Mm. And then one day, it was red, and we're able to give him something. And then while we continue driving, she's like, Lord, please make a way for him so that he'll get off the street, because he was walking with a limp, you know, that he would get off the street. And, you know, we haven't seen him in a while, so we're thinking, okay, you know, our prayers were answered. You know, the Lord did help him to get off the street. And then last week, I packed a plate. I saw so many food was going to be wasted, so I grabbed a to-go container. So I was telling her, I said, hey, just in case our friend is there, you know, I could give him this plate, and I have a book in my car. And then, you know, she was like, well, Lord, if he's not there, let somebody else get it. And, you know, he wasn't there, so hey, she, what if God answered our prayers for real and took him off the street, you know? And I carried the plate, and somebody else got it. And it so happened that Carrie was on the phone. It was right at Union City. The light was red, and we gave him the bowl, and he was like, are you guys, you know, he was basically thinking that we're, you know, Adventists, or we're Christians, not Adventists, but, you know, for the fact that we stopped and we gave him a whole, well, it was a bag with food, oranges, juice. He had like a whole meal in there, you know, and he was saying, God bless you. And, you know, he was so thankful. So that is our way of sharing Jesus with someone outside of, you know, just giving them a track.
Thank you for sharing that. Sorry that I was also getting it. Does that, someone else have another one, 2 minutes or less?
So I work in an hospital, and my unit has 42 beds. But the first room is room 27. And I always encourage the patients who are in that room to make this the praise room. And they are so excited that they are the first person in the unit, so let it be the praise room. So whenever anybody comes into the unit, they know that this is a praise room, and the praise will continue through the unit. And my presence there, my floor, my medical surgical floor in the hospital. I said I work in the hospital. But I mean, being there is a blessing because persons are really happy when I'm there. They like when I'm there because the spirituality is there, and we just encourage persons to trust God to be the healer.
Amen. Amen. And Jeff had one, and then we will move on so that I can follow the timeline that I've been given. I will do my best to do so. You don't know me well enough, but I'm very long-winded and love to talk forever.
I work around, like, pretty rough guys. I'm a carpenter. And so I don't present myself as too good for that. I'll talk with them, but I don't talk about, you know, the women, the drugs, because I've never done a drug. Like, I just never have.
Good for you.
I mean, and I tell them that, and then they make fun of me, but I laugh, you know, whatever.
But it's a good thing.
Yeah, right? But, you know, but I'll be the butt of their joke.
How will you?
Just, you know, no, but, like, I'll agree to it. Like, you know, I don't care. But I will change the conversation into, like, why I've never done that. And I'll mention Jesus and that. So I didn't used to do that, but more in the last couple years I've started doing that. And with this crew that I'm with, that I've worked with a couple times over the years. And now they will ask me questions. So I haven't offered a Bible study yet. I would like to do that. But they'll approach me, and I can tell that they trust my answers are, like, I'm being honest, at least, you know, or heartfelt. But I think offering a Bible study is that next step, and I haven't done that.
Amen. Thank you for sharing that. So just acknowledging Christ in your life. I have found this too. I hang out with a lot of non-Adventists. I mean, how can I witness if I'm only hanging out with Adventists? I'm just going to be honest, if all my friends are Adventists, something's wrong. So I hang out with non-Adventists a lot. Go ahead, real quick.
Okay, so I'm a nurse also. Uh-huh. I work in a clinic for elderly, and it's a vascular clinic, and we do vascular procedures. I'm good at many things, but I'm really good at one thing, and that is to start IVs on most difficult patients. And so I encountered this one patient who was so difficult, but I was able to stick her without any problems. So I went to see my doctor, who was next door, and hadn't planned to go into my workplace, but after I was done with my doctor, I went over to my workplace, and they were frustrated because here was this lady had come in that day, and no one could stick her. So she was about to go back home, and here I came. And so she just started to cry, and she said, "Ms. Iceland, can you try?" And so I tried, and of course I was successful at doing that. But before I stuck her, and she was crying, I prayed with, I said, "Would you like me to pray with you?" And so she said, "Yes." And she said, "I didn't know nurses could pray for people in their jobs." So I prayed for her, hugged her, and then we started the IV. When she came back the next time, she came on the day that I was working, and I was able to stick her, and we prayed again. And before she left to go home, she said, "Ms. Iceland, what church do you go to?" And of course, I was proud to tell her I was an Adventist. And she said, "What does that mean?" And of course, I was able to tell her about that. And she said, "Do you have any books on that?" And of course, that gave me the opportunity to mail her some books, a couple of our books, Steps to Christ and The Great Controversy. And so I
you know, I have been able to minister, now that I'm retired and gone back to work, I've been able to minister to the elderly that I work with and to people that I work with. My neighbor, now I collect food, enough food from our pantry so I can share with her, but then I share the books with her as well. So thank God for those opportunities.
Thank you for sharing that. Yeah. Isn't it simple? Sometimes we really overcomplicate evangelism. We make it hard. We make it where, oh, I got to go to this training. And sometimes, and I'm going to be honest with you, I don't know if anybody in this group, none of us fall into this. Maybe one or two of us, I don't know, fall into the, I need training, I need training, I need training, I need training, but there's never any doing. There's been 20 years of training on Sabbath afternoons, but never a going and doing. And that doesn't work out to anything. Even someone who has no idea what is going on, if they have an experience with Jesus Christ, can win people to the Lord. That's all it takes. All it takes. Now, I designed this for rejection at the door. How many of you are going door knocking and following up on leads with the leads program here at the church? A couple of you. Several of you, actually. More hands are coming up. So there's rejection at the door, and then there's rejection when we offer to our friend. Which one's more scary? Your friend? You think they don't want to be friends with you anymore, huh? Oh, they offered me a Bible study. I hate the guts. Never talk to me again. Well, if you're their friend, then do they really hate you? Nah, they're just going to tell you, nah, I'm not really interested. And they make a joke out of it or something. Or they'll just kind of throw it to the side. Or they'll say yes and then not follow through with you. But you still love them. And if you've been working on building that relationship with them, at the door, it's easier to get rejected than it is through your friend. And it actually happens more often rejected at a door than it does with your friend. Now, I go door to door and I follow up on leads for one reason. Because I meet people who are praying to God to send someone to them at their house to help them know him. That's why I go. Because God is using me as an answer to their prayer. The time is now, not later. The reason that we go now is because if we don't go today, and we don't go tomorrow, and we don't go next week, and we don't go the next month, we lose the passion to go. We lose it. We get used to just doing church instead of doing Christianity, instead of sharing the best news that we've ever had. My wife and I were at a church. We went in. It was a little bitty church, and they had the tiniest fellowship hall you ever seen. And we sat down to eat. And as we're eating, we had our meal, we had some dessert, we got in the car, it was snowing. We were driving home in the snow, and my wife goes, I just had the best pie I've ever had in my life. Really? I'm just now hearing about it. Can't get the pie anymore. Because it's not in the car with us. It's sitting in a church. Not with us anymore. Why would you not tell somebody about the best pie you've ever eaten? Now, you know what flavor pie that was, right? Oh, apparently no one knows what flavor of pie that is. All right. It was sweet potato pie. So I got some. Okay. There were some people on board with that here. Sweet potato pie is incredible.
Yes.
And neither of us had ever had it. So when we got home, she made me a sweet potato pie to make up for that horrific mistake. Now, and it was incredible. But I have never forgotten that feeling of why didn't you share it with me then? Now, here's the thing. I don't want to talk about how other people are going to feel. We have the best news, the best experience. We have experienced Jesus Christ. You've got something the world is longing for. Just share it. You can share it through acts of kindness and praying with people. You can befriend your friends at work who are the vilest of the vile. These are the fishermen of the day. The carpenters and the ones that are building the houses, you hang out with them, it's rough. They ain't talking nothing good in there. I know, I used to work doing glass work and installing stuff in the houses. And yeah, it's a rough place. And you are different. You are different because you have Jesus in your life. Right there, you're different. I hang out with non-Adventists on purpose. And I go to a film club. Judge me all you like, I'm fine with it. It's okay. I've told you what I do for fun. I hang out and I go to a film club because I like film, and so do they. It's like going to a fishing club if you like fishing, or going to a knitting club if you like knitting. That was almost too hard to say. All right. And just getting involved with people that do what you do. And then talking and just being their friend. But some, after a little while, you are different than everyone else. You stand out, and not like a sore thumb, but like in a beautiful mural kind of way compared to everything else there. And people start talking to you about your faith. They start asking you about your Jesus. They start asking you questions about the Bible. When in this film club that I go to, well, when the guy who runs it, when his mom died, he called me because I was the only spiritual person he knew. And so I had to learn to do a funeral. And I gave him the best I could give. And I meet with him every couple weeks. We go out to eat and we talk. And I encourage him. And I'm building that relationship. Some of them will come out to hear me preach. And they go back to the group and they're like, you got to go see Jack preach. This is Jack doing his thing. You got to come out and see. You got to hear these words. Some of them, I've given steps to Christ. Some of them are like, hey, you're a preacher, man. That's what I heard, right? Man, where do you go to church? I'd like to come. So you start getting involved in people's lives. You start having them at your house on Thanksgiving. You start bringing them into your life. They're going to want what you got because you got something.
Yeah.
I wasn't a Seventh-day Adventist. And Seventh-day Adventist got something that I longed for. And when I found it, it changed my life. You got it. You just got to get involved in their life and share it. All right, I'm skipping all that. All right. Those of you who want it, I'll give it to you. But let me say this one. I got a thing on the screen for you. Oh, you can read it this way. Here is evangelism. That man looks like he needs a tract. That guy's obviously thinking shallow thoughts as he smokes and drinks his beer. Banzai, the guy jumps on him, grabs him by the neck. Believe or die, believe or die. Take my track and believe. And as the man runs away for his life, you must believe. Well, at least I sowed some seed. What kind of seed is that? I mean, there's some seed sown there, but what does that grow into? Church people are crazy. I don't want anything to do with Christianity. Keep them away from me. I'm never taking a tract, and I'm not hanging out with any of those people. I remember picking up the tracts, and you remember, I met a girl at an event recently, and non-Christian, but she collects all those old tracts where the people are burning in hell at the end. And they're like, oh, I wish I would have not done that. And they're in hell and the demons are torturing them. Those are the tracts that I got that made me not interested in Christianity. You have something better than that. And this is kind of from the sermon this morning. Man has his part to act in promoting the growth of the grain. He must prepare and enrich the soil and cast in the seed. He must till the fields. The fields are the soil. This is their hearts. You need to work people's hearts. You got to love them. You want Bible studies? You got to love people. You want to go to the door and meet someone at the door? You better let them know you love them in a couple minutes. They got to get it. They got to pick it up. And as you go back and you go back with them, they need to learn that you love them. And then you can really share seed and it will grow in their life. But there's a point beyond which you can do nothing. You can share seed and hopefully not like that guy. But there's a point where you can't do anything with it. You can sow seed, but there's a point where you can do nothing. That part belongs to God. You sow the seed and you trust God to grow it. That's it. So sometimes we're dealing with rejection, and I've got a verse up here to encourage you, but I need to bring this up before we close down today. Look at this. You got the violently against Christian person. You got the hostile toward Christianity, cynical. You got the neutral person. You got curious. You got searching. You got the unstoppable Christian. Sometimes we want to go from violently against Christian to unstoppable Christian in a five-minute meeting. And then we're disappointed because we didn't baptize somebody. We're trying to baptize everybody. It is not your responsibility to take every person you witness to from zero to baptize to unstoppable Christian in one experience. It actually takes somewhere around 30 links, 30 significant experiences with Christians to bring someone from zero to all in. That means you're a part of the chain. You're a part of the process. So if you meet them at hostile, maybe you're kind to these people. You treat them well. When no other Christian seems to treat them well, you show them the love of Christ. And it moves them from hostile maybe to neutral or kind of curious. And then someone else comes along when they're curious and they journey with them a little bit and they pray with them and they share a tract or they share something about Jesus with them and they get a little more open and they're kind of searching. And then someone shows up and says, oh, hey, would you like Bible studies? And they're searching and they're getting the Bible studies. And you don't even realize that kind act you did for them on that one day, years later, they're sitting in a Bible study group. Or years later, they're sitting in a church because you'll never know. Those guys that came to my door with the videos, they don't know. Can you imagine the surprise in heaven? They have no idea. Like I said, the only reason I know is because I met the pastor years later and he told me the story on their side of things. That's the only reason I know that.
You said that was me.
I said, hey man, I got these things. And he told me, like, all the stuff that had been going on with it. Christ's servants are to labor expecting a harvest from the seed they sow. You throw out the seed, you till the soil, you love people and share the word of God with them. And you know there's going to be a harvest. You just may not be the harvester. You just know it's going to happen. There are people, though, you're going to meet and get to harvest them. You are going to find ripe berries. Be open to that and expect it because it will happen. The good seed, now this is what I want to give you this. Don't miss this one. The good seed may for a time lie unnoticed in a cold, selfish, worldly heart, giving no evidence that it's taken root. Don't miss that. You have shared the seed, the word of God, with somebody, and it might sit there for years, unnoticed. In a cold, selfish, worldly heart, giving no evidence that anything's going on. Don't get discouraged. You may have been rejected for the moment, but God is at work with that seed. And when the time is right, afterward is the Spirit of God. Notice, the Spirit of God breathes on the soul. The hidden seed springs up and at last bears fruit. That's going to take some time, and you got to be okay with it. In our life work, we know not which shall prosper, this or that. We cast this seed or that seed. Sometimes we want to judge. Oh, this is the one. I found him. You're going to get baptized. I know it. Here you go. That's not our job. Watch this. This is not the question for us to settle. What's prospering? That's not for us. We are to do our work and leave the results to God. And I promise you, if you do this work, you will find lots of people who are ready to study the Bible. I promise you. You know what, how I can promise you that? Because I meet lots of people that others have been investing in the past, and I meet them when they're ready to study the Bible. That's how I know that. So if you're willing to go forward, you got to work while the sun is shining. If you're willing to go forward right now, God will give you somebody. If you're willing to ask for Bible studies, you will get them. You'll get some no's. That's okay. But you will get some yeses. We are to do the work, our work, and leave the results with God. Oh, here's a couple Bible verses for you. In the morning sow thy seed, and in the evening withhold not thy hand. Sow that seed. Sow it like it's going out of style. Sow it because Jesus is coming back soon. Sow it because right now we can sow it. We are living in a time of ease for sharing the gospel. As easy as, well, it's ever been for me since I've been a Seventh-day Adventist. But we do know that there will be a time that won't be easy. And then we'll be doing the work when it's hard. Might as well learn when it's easy. Because when it's hard, it'll be hard. All right, Psalm 126, he that goeth forth and weepeth, bearing precious seed, shall doubtless come again with rejoicing, bringing his sheaves with him. You may go forward with weeping. It may be hard. There may be some disappointment. There might be some rejection. There will be. Not every berry's ripe. But keep looking for those ripe berries and you will find them. You will come in rejoicing. When one of your friends that you've been sharing Jesus with gets baptized or comes to church, last night, two people that I've been working with last night came to that agape feast with me at my church, and we washed feet, and we had communion, and we sang Christian songs, and they said they started asking questions about the church. They left the Seventh-day Adventist church when they were teenagers. One of them went into Satanism. The other one just kind of went. And here they are in my living room every week getting to know Jesus. And last night they sat in a worship service and were really interested in the church there that I go to. I want you to know that I am rejoicing in that. I wanted to jump up and down in the middle of everybody. But I was trying to play it cool. All right. But that's the reality of this work. There will be the rejoicing. The rejoicing makes all of the weeping and the hardships worth it. The rejoicing is yours. I have to stop. My time is over. If you have questions, I am here.
Okay, I have, for the last few years, have been doing my personal evangelisms with my company through prayer on a private Facebook group. And recently, I would say for the last 6 months, I have been introducing people to a personal prayer time that I have at 5:40, 6:40, and 7:40 a.m. And each month, I'll switch and have new people. So recently, for 2024, God kind of, you know, revealed to me that he's going to start opening my eyes and showing me certain things. So recently I saw that people around me that either work for me or my personal assistant or friends per se were into witchcraft, like heavy, like Wiccan and stuff. And so immediately, and actually Natasha helped me to realize some of that too. So recently I was like, okay, I'm just going to leave Georgia because this is just too much. I don't know how to deal with this. And when you mentioned today that, the Christians that came to your door because of some of the things you were in, I don't know if they felt that or not, they left. So I was wondering, as a Christian, when you're dealt with that type of thing, because I, like, right now where I am, because, you know, I have so many vulnerable people around me, like my children, I just kind of
choose to stay away from people who have chosen that lifestyle for themselves. But as a Christian, like, what would be your recommendation in terms of, okay, if we don't have to deal with those types of people, if we can just say, okay, I'm no longer going to do it, although they care about us and they love us and they want to be around us, what would you recommend in a situation like
that? That's a big question. Big question. A lot of things there. So personally, when I'm around someone who's into those things, start with prayer. I start with prayer for everybody.
Yeah.
But I start praying intentionally for them. I start praying that the bounds of Satan will be loosed, that the power of Satan over them will be diminished, and that God's angels will have access to work in their life, that the Holy Spirit can reach their hearts. I'm praying for these things specifically. I'm praying for the downfall of the power of the enemy and their, like, working for them.
Yeah.
I pray for all of that stuff, and I'm praying for opportunities to share. And if they're open, I only give a tiny bit.
Okay.
Okay? And if they're open to that, I may give more. But I'll share with them. But I love them. I'm kind with them. I'm not accepting their stuff into my life,
mm-hmm.
but I am there with them. Those things don't scare me.
Right.
I'm just going to be honest, because I'm a Christian. I mean, I'm covered by the Lord.
Power.
Yeah, that stuff got nothing on me.
Exactly.
All right? The Lord,
yeah.
I believe if you believe those things have power over you, they will have power
right.
over you.
Exactly.
My faith is in the Lord, and I know that He controls. So I just follow the Lord's leading. This is one thing that I'm really careful about, is as I'm praying for people, I'm watching the working of the Holy Spirit
mm-hmm.
and their response to what the Holy Spirit's doing.
Mm-hmm.
And I follow God's leading. If God says leave a track, I'm going to do it even if I don't want it.
Yeah.
And I'm going to tell Him I don't want it, but I'm going to leave it
mm-hmm.
and see what happens. And then when they respond with an openness or a curiosity, that's when I'm going to offer prayer with them, or I'm going to offer an encouraging Bible verse with them.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm always going to keep my stuff grounded in God with them. I will be more careful to just stay focused, but at the same time, I'm going to love them like they've never been loved, because most non-Christians, and especially those into other things, believe Christians are some of the worst people in the world.
Yeah.
And so breaking those barriers gives you access to their life.
Okay.
That's all I got.
Thank you.
I don't know if that...
I've had the opportunity time and time again in my past to deal with individuals who are dealing with demoniac spirits. And there is a place, first and foremost, I would say to Belinda, too, that before you go to approach individuals at doors, you need coverage. You need to prepare yourself. You need to cover yourself with Psalms 51. You need to seek God's strength. Remember the story with the disciples who went out to heal, because God had given them authority to go. And when they approached the demoniac said to God's children, he said, listen, I know Barry, I know Griffiths. Who are you? You know, so even the demoniac is pointing back and challenging them. And they were unsuccessful because Satan is far more wiser than we are. But we only have the source that gives us the power and the authority is Christ. So when they came back to Jesus, they said, Lord, what did we do wrong? We followed the process. We follow what we should. We've seen how you've done it. Why were we not successful? And Jesus said, there are some things that only come by prayer and fasting. So that element of preparing yourself, praying, giving yourself totally and asking for God protection around you and to give you the holy boldness, God will give that. To him that come to me, I'll in no wise cast away. And God is excited to work with us when we are willing. And then there's no telling what God can do. But preparation is critical, that you go there knowing that Satan is going to zero in on you. So you need to be fully armed with the power of Christ, with the Spirit
Amen.
Of God, and He will guide.
Amen. And Christ, like, this is one of the things that I love. I know we're not talking about casting out demons or anything like that, but the reality is that we're talking about our dependence upon Christ. And that's really what it comes down to. If you just allow Christ to fight these battles, he'll fight them. There's a book that's on this topic that I really appreciated called Demons or Angels, and I really liked it. It went through a lot of stories of people mixed up in the occult and witnessing with them and how, I mean, it's a little more heavy, but I really appreciate it. It gave me a lot of insight on those things. Any other questions? Because Jeff's got one, and we'll, you said 15 minutes, 40 minutes ago.
I just have more of a statement than a question. When Belinda was sharing what she shared with, I've had situations like that before, and I used to hide under a bushel. I would try to fit in. I would try to be like one of the guys. But now, I guess maybe I've gotten older or whatever. I'm over 40, but like, I just have this idea that like I'm going to live loud. Like, I'm not a loud person, but rather, like, my faith, I'm gonna live it loud.
Amen.
Like, why are we hiding at this point? We have, you know, the confidence. We have the confidence that what God has done for us. But like, I can remember growing up, and I would just try to fit in, hide, pretend, dress like everyone else, do what the other guys were doing. You know, now it's like, forget that. No.
Amen. I just want to thank you for just sharing how you're praying, and inviting people to join in that. That's really something special.
To add to what Brother Jeff was saying, because sometimes when we're in this protective cocoon of church, we are comfortable, but when we have to mingle with people who are different from us, it's really hard. And I remember when I came here to this country, and then I had to work in the hospitals, and it was just constant cursing, and that was their norm. And I felt like I just kind of want to hide away. I'm like, I don't want to be here. But then God had to show me that I didn't have to, you don't have to be like persons. You just be yourself and ask the Spirit to just help you to be kind to others. And what I recognized, that one of the persons who kept cursing was an Adventist. And when he realized who I was, but we became friends, and then he realized that, you know, what he was doing wasn't right. And then he literally stopped, and we became very good friends. And I could just tell he just felt relieved, because when you're in a situation where nobody knows who you are, you can be somebody else. And it also helped me too, because especially because I teach in a non-Christian environment, I can't pray before I start my classes. And it was really hard at first, but then I realized the same thing, that we need to win people's confidence. You don't have to even to declare who you are. People will see Jesus in you. And I would sit with my students, and they would tell me stories about their tattoos and what it meant. I'm like, oh, now I know why people do what they do. It's not that they're evil and they just want to put demons on them. It's because of how they were cultured, and, you know, they just don't know better. And, you know, you help to understand. And, you know, they tell stories that they eat dogs and all. I'm like, but, you know, they're open to talk. And I'm like, you know, that's really where Jesus wants us to go. You start a conversation with somebody, and once you build their trust. But on the flip side to it, that some people do, we must admit, have an easier job reaching people, because you have a story. I mean, I grew up in the church. I don't have a story. You understand what I mean? That, you know, because that's how people can't relate.
You got a great story.
I don't have a story. And sometimes I would be jealous.
Don't make me tell you that I'm jealous of your story.
Sometimes
and don't
I
ever say you're jealous of
people
of
who
this
come story. From the outside,
oh,
because I,
come on,
okay, they had
that.
A story. I don't have a story.
Man,
but
can I tell you what my story causes? Horrible scars in my marriage, in my relationships with people, mental memory things. Like there are times I just can't remember that I talked to you 30 seconds ago, or what I did yesterday.
Right.
From the lifestyle that I chose to live.
Yeah.
The damage that it caused on my ability to trust people. What it did to, like,
Okay,
like,
I understand.
I'm jealous. Let me tell you, this is what a lot of Adventists don't realize. Most of us that came from the very, very poor choices are jealous of you and wish we had your story. But we would give for that story. I'll tell you what.
I think also, too, that sometimes why we are afraid to witness is the, as you said, the rejection. Sometimes you work so hard with people, and I've had that experience where you feel like you don't see the seed growing, and it's hard. But, you know, it really should be left up to Christ, because I remember I taught a student like 10 years ago, and it was just recently she called me and, you know, said that she wanted to be closer drawn to Christ. And that was after 10 years. So don't be afraid to plant the seed, because you never know where it's going to go.
Right. Amen. Thank you. So we're going to stop for time's sake. I would encourage you to do some conversation classes that build relationships and trust. One of the most important things is that you're able to build some trust with people, because and non-judgmental. Leave all judgmental statements aside as you interact with some non-Christians or non-church members who don't share or go to church with you, and even inside the church, please. But leave those judgmental statements aside, because that's what they're expecting from you. That is the Christians are viewed as judgmental by most of the world. That the statement going to come from you is a judgment upon them, their lifestyle. So if you want to reach your kids, quit talking to them about their lifestyle. I'm just going to tell you up front. That lifestyle conversation with your kids over and over isn't helping you win their soul. It's building a wall. And you're going to have to work on building trust with them again, just like you would someone else who didn't grow up with what they had. And when the time's right, you might be able to share with them. But fix that thing first. Same thing with non-Christians that you're trying to witness to. Leave the judgment aside and just love them right where they're at. And that'll go a long way to being able to share the Lord with them. As you're going to visit the doors and follow up on these leads, some of these people actually want Bible studies. And you're going to find people to sit down and study the Bible with, and it's going to be scary. Only because you make it scary. Because you're scared, and they're nervous that you're going to judge them. And when they realize you love them, and you realize that they wanted to know what the Bible said, you'll come out of there walking on a cloud. Literally, walking on a cloud. Literally, no. That's impossible. Figuratively, but that doesn't sound the same. Let me pray for you. We got to end. We went over. I just want to thank you for the stories you shared today. I thank you for the encouragement that you're sharing with your church family as you're sharing what God is doing through you. Man, I loved hearing this. Sometimes we think we're the only one. I'm the only one that hasn't bowed the knee, Lord. Come on now, you're not alone. We're here together. All over the conference, I'm hearing stories like this. All over. God is doing things through his people. Keep it up. Keep it up. Let me pray for you. Father, Lord, we want to come before you and just thank you that you are so good you would use weak and erring men like your disciples. That when they argued and they fought and they had bad tendencies and they had issues in their life and they didn't talk like they should, you still use them to share the gospel. And you have used us. And we're not perfect. And you've told us you want to use us, Lord. So thank you for that. Thank you for being willing to use us to share you. Lord, we pray that you use us to share seed everywhere. But Lord, show us those who are ripe. Show us those who are on the verge of the kingdom. Lord, we want to be used. We want to find those people. We want to meet them, and we want to have eyes to notice them. So Lord, give us those eyes and take us to those places. Take us to those people and give us the courage and the boldness to offer you to them. Lord, I pray that you bless this church and you bless each individual in this room right now with someone to share your word with. Lord, we pray that you are working out the situation with those who are involved in Wicca, that you are providing opportunities and avenues into their heart We pray that you continue to provide opportunities at workplaces to be able to share who you are to us. Lord, we pray for, as we witness to our family members and to our neighbors, that you are shining your light upon that scene. Give us the privilege of seeing you work in their lives. Lord, we pray your blessing upon us as we go forward, expecting a harvest, expecting to find ripe berries. We pray this in your name, Jesus, and we will rejoice in your name, Father. Amen. Thank you for spending the day together. It's been a blast. When Pastor gets me back out.